Yeah. so very glad that you're here today. I hope you were able to grab a weekly on your way in. You can find some important information in there, as well as a way to connect with us if you would like to send in a prayer request, connect with myself or Pastor Nate during the week. Go ahead and fill that out, and then place those in the giving boxes located in the foyer at the close of the service, and we'd love to hear from you. Couple brief announcements before we go a little further. We've got more later, but we have a lot going on, so we're going to spread them out a little bit today. Hopefully we'll remember them more. Our State Street Student Sundays next week is going sledding. I think there's supposed to be some more snow coming. I would not be surprised with this crazy weather, but you see our graphic there. The reason I want to get that out there now, and if they're in our middle school class, they're going to hear more about that in their class, and we've got some flyers so that they can take those home. We do need permission slips filled out for that because we are going off-site. So if you have a middle schooler or a high schooler that wants to participate in sledding, they're going to eat lunch here, they're going to go sledding, they're going to come back, have some hot cocoa. A fun time will be had by all. You can stop by the Welcome Center and pick up one of those, a flyer and a permission slip if you have a child that would like to participate in that. Secondly, our very own Krista Loucks, who's singing today, is doing a fundraiser, and you may have heard of this a couple weeks ago. You can have the pleasure of winning, throwing a pie in her face. It's a pretty good looking mug there. And if you want to throw a pie in her face, you can enter into a raffle. It's $1, a raffle ticket, or 6 tickets for $5, and then she's going to draw, and the winner gets to throw a pie in her face, and all that is going towards the PAC Center. And so if you have questions about that, Krista will be at the Welcome Center in between services. So it's a good day. I know it's cold outside, but it's lovely to be in here and to gather with people and to recognize Jesus Christ. We're going to lift up that name. We're going to recognize his presence in this place, and we're so glad that you're here to join us. Thank you.
bones you're about to move. I feel it in the wind you're about to ride in. You said that you would pour your spirit out. You said that you would fall on sons and daughters. So
our big song is one thing to know.
if we ask, we'll receive, and we're asking for the greater measure. And what is that greater measure? It's more of Him. We're asking for more of His presence, more of that Spirit that's here. May we recognize it. May we lean into it. May we be transformed by the beauty of it. Amen.
Oh,
Amen. Welcome to State Street. If you are new with us, we are glad that you're here. If you are watching on Facebook Live, welcome as well from the comfort of your own home. I am glad that you made it out today. I got here this morning and I thought, there's a chill in the air. And then somebody told me it's 0 degrees today, and I'm glad to hear that it really is just cold. So we have a great day here planned, a great time of worship, of gathering, of connection not only to Christ but this community. But before we get into our next message on our values series, I want to welcome up a friend who wants to kind of say hi to you. This is a friend of my family's, a friend of mine, a friend of many people here. He's been a friend of State Street's for quite some time, and he is here talking to people about the ministry and Jack Mulhady and kind of sharing an update of what's happening. Now, if you want to be a part of this ministry, I 100% encourage you to talk to Jean-Claude not after my message, because he's going to stay in here for a little while, but after the service, he'll be out in the foyer. And maybe you'd like to support them, or you'd like to be a part of visiting Haiti and seeing the work. He would love to connect you with that. But better than myself talking about it, I want to invite my friend Jean-Claude to give us an update today.
Good morning, church, and thank you, Pastor Nate, for letting me get in here. And I'm not here because I miss the snow. But I'm here just briefly to give you an update from the Ministry of Haiti, Calvary Church, what we're doing. So we're doing fine. The church is doing fine. You know, the ministry is just doing great. Keep feeding thousands of children. And if you want to be a part of that, if you want to get more information, and after the service, like Pastor Nate told you, I will be over by the booth. And we are really in great need of financial support, in great needs. As the country is not doing well, but Calvary Church, you know, Haitian Support Ministry, we stand firm there, spreading the good news and supporting the children, send them to school, feeding them on a daily basis. So please, you know, join us as we are in great need over there. And if you want to talk about that, I'll be there. I'll be there and give you, you know, real updates about what's going on. And if you want to get involved, we have pledge cards, $10 a month to support a child at the feeding center, $30, you know, for restoration ministry to send a kid to school and give me hot meal a day, buy school supplies, and so, and supporting, you know, school nutrition program. We're feeding over 3,000 kids 5 days a week through food we receive from networking with other organizations. But Haitian Support Ministries, we need money to do that. Thanks. God bless you.
Thank you. Yes. So if you've not met Pastor Jean-Claude, I encourage you, even if you can't support the ministry, do say hi afterwards. Talk to him. Hear his heart for what's happening in Haiti. But if you can support, just $10 a month helps support a child there. $30 a month helps not only feed a child, but put them in school as well, right? And so I know my kids cost well over $30 a month. So that's a pretty good deal. So thank you so much for being here, Pastor Jean-Claude. So we are in a series right now on values, and we are talking about different values as a community here. And we've kind of defined values as the standards of behavior that we have, right? Kind of what's important in life. We have a diverse community that comes from different theological backgrounds. We have people from different political backgrounds here. We have people that believe different things about certain issues, and we love that. We want to value diversity of opinion here. We want to value diversity of background here. But what we also want to do is make sure we're going all in the same direction, though. We want to make sure that we're at least kind of embodying the same kind of values as we go forward as people. As we kind of talk about the differences that we have and embrace the differences and live in the tension of our disbelief and honoring each other in our differences, rather. We want to also make sure, though, that even though we do disagree on some things, we're going to the same direction. The leadership team last summer, as I told you last week, we got together this summer at Lillimere, and we started defining some of the most important values. And we had pieces of giant post-its on the wall as we just started talking about what are the things that make us a peculiar community here? What are the things that kind of give us life here? The current, the electricity that helps kind of bring out the community here. And we started identifying certain things, and then we pared it down and said, okay, over the last couple of months, what are the five kind of things that help define us as a community? And what are the values that we believe all of our community, if you're here, should embrace so that we're going towards the right places? And so we, at the beginning of this, we said, you know what, we don't want to make these exhaustive values. We have other values. You might have personal values. You have familial values. You have maybe neighborhood values or community values. So we want to say this is a beginning point of definition for our community, just the beginning. We might continue to evolve. Obviously, we want to give ourselves permission to change, but this is a beginning point of definition for our community here at State Street. Last week, we talked about purposeful location. State Street is an expression of Christian faith in downtown LaPorte that values purposeful location. We value the place that we are. And as people of Christ, we look at the place that we are as a calling as well, that God has given us place as well. He's given us location to flourish. And so we're not cynical about the place that we are. We're not pessimistic about this place. We look at the place that we are as a gift from God that he allows us to flourish in. Purposeful location. Now today, we're going to talk about justice. One of our values here is justice. Obviously, we did a series on Amos recently, and we talked all about justice. Amos is a book in the Old Testament, and the permeating theme throughout all of Amos is the idea that God cares about justice, and that God is just, and that God invites his people to participate in love and justice. Justice. And I often hear disagreement about this, and I hear different people maybe not understanding our values for justice. And our values for justice isn't just because we think it's cool. It's because we believe that it's the natural outpouring of faith. That if we worship these songs that we sing honestly, and we believe that Jesus truly did defeat death on the cross, and he's restoring all that which is broken in us and in our neighborhoods, the path of justice then is just a natural outpouring of our faith. There is no Christianity without people concerned about justice, because this is the path that Christ invites us down. It's been the path that God has shown his people since the beginning. Justice. So this is what the value says, and we'll put that online just like we did last week. If you're not a fan of ours or like our page on Facebook, I encourage you to go to State Street Community Church and like that, or on Instagram if you're on Instagram, or the Twitter. If you're on the Twitter, like us on there too. Justice. So we believe that God has created humanity in love and goodness. You were created, so were your neighbors, so were your children, so were your parents, so were your ancestors, so are the people you don't like, which is always tense for me. We're created out of God's love and goodness. All of creation was created in love and goodness. And our faith has to start there. It has to start that God actually creates out of love and goodness, because sometimes it shifts and we see so much negativity and we see so much brokenness that we believe that God creates brokenness. And God creates people in brokenness, when the actual affirmation of our faith
is that God has created humanity in love and goodness. Though brokenness does exist in the form of personal and systemic injustices, there is brokenness. We feel a sense of calling to restorative justice, not retributive, but restorative justice, where the wrongs of this world are made right again in our own lives, because it has to start first with ourselves, in the lives of our neighbors, and in this world. We believe this. We believe that God is created out of goodness and love, but goodness and love doesn't always show itself in ways that we can see. And God calls us back to that. And God calls us to be people of restoration and redemption and resurrection that leads to justice, where the wrongs of this world are made right again. See, the scriptures continually remind God's people that God loves justice. God loves it when the broken things, the places, and the people are made right again. God loves that, right? Isaiah 61:8 starts, "For I, the Lord, love justice." I love justice. I think we have to understand that we don't participate in justice just because we love justice. When we actually participate in just work, when we help feed the poor, take care of the widow, love the orphan, care for the marginalized, create community where it didn't exist, help understand where people are coming from, when we participate in these works, it's actually scratching at the surface of who God is, because God loves justice. We're not doing anything that God doesn't already want us to do. We're invited to the work that God is already doing in this world. Then also, God's justice is restorative. There's obviously a difference between restorative justice and retributive justice. I don't know about you, but whenever I see practical expressions of restorative justice, it resonates in a place deep inside of me. For instance, locally here, when I see the work of our drug court, for example, when I see people that are broken, that have committed, let's say, crimes or whatever, and their life was a mess, and they've paid the punishment, but they've also been restored again to new life. That's so much better to me than just retributive justice. They did a crime, they paid the time, and now they're done. Well, that's not a good story. That's not new life. That's not new creation. God's justice is restorative. It creates new life where it didn't exist in the past. It creates a new creation where death existed before. God's justice is always bringing us into new life. This is why I think the church needs to consistently check itself when we believe that the major theme of the scriptures is judgmentalism. That people's stories are final, in your opinion, that they are who they are, and I know who they are, and God doesn't want anything to do with them. But he does with me, obviously. But God's justice is always restorative. And the worst people that you can think of often have parallels in the scriptures as well. And if we're honest with ourselves, there are people in our life that can probably look at us and say, yeah, who do you think you are? God's justice is restorative. It takes people like Paul, who persecuted Christians, who was a Jew amongst Jews, a Pharisee, and knew all of the rules, knew all of the laws, and followed them all, and he was willing to kill Christians if it came to that. Yet, God's justice was restorative, and Paul, the persecutor, became Paul, the persecuted, and he found new life. He was a new creation. As soon as we close the door to people and things and situations, we stop believing that God's justice is restorative. Finally, I think the scriptures continually remind us that God's people, that God invites his people to participate in the work of restorative justice. Not that just God loves justice and God's justice is restorative, but God's people are the hands and feet of this restorative justice in this world. So when we see forgiveness happen, this is a sign of restorative justice. That, yes, there was a wrong, but the wrong has been made right again. This is restorative justice. When we see somebody who is trapped in their brokenness or their addiction get free from that and try to gain restoration from that and try to, with the power of Christ in their life, continue to go towards a path of wholeness, we see restoration there. And God invites us to be participants in that in this world. Not to stand outside of that work, but to get our hands dirty within that work. So the Old Testament is probably filled more so with text about justice, because the idea of a just people is on the forefront of the author's minds in the midst of exile, Babylon. They're in the midst of a culture where they don't share their values, they don't share their beliefs, and they're trying to come up with what is just then. How do we live in the midst of a culture and a world where we don't always agree with the people that we're living around? How do we live in a world where we see more death and oppression and violence than we see life and peace and wholeness? And the prophets continually remind the people, God's people in that time, that you are called to be people of justice, right? Isaiah, at the beginning of Isaiah, says, wash yourselves, make yourselves clean. So think about what's in your life. Think about your own brokenness, your own sins. Remove the evil of your doings from before my eyes. Cease to do evil. Learn to do good. I love that idea, and I've always thought about kind of expounding and doing more study on what that means to learn to do good. To actually, it like we learn mathematics, you know, it takes a process of learning, and you start here and you continue to learn to be virtuous, to do good. And then it says, seek justice, rescue the oppressed, defend the orphan, plead for the widow. Now the oppressed, the orphan, the widow, these are the downtrodden in that society. These are those that have no voice. These are those that have no people. They have no advocates. And for God, he says, this is what I want you to do. Seek justice by rescuing the oppressed, defending the orphan, and pleading for the widow. Now, we still ought to do these things, but we also understand that justice in our culture might look a little bit different. We might not have as many widows, or we might not have as many orphans, or we might have widows in this society, might have, who knows? I think every community and culture is different, but might have a better path to success than they did 3,000 years ago in Isaiah's time, or maybe they don't. But I think the key is to seek justice. Look at the broken places and the broken people, and look at the broken events in this world, and do what you can to help restore the brokenness, to be the hands and feet of God in that context. Isaiah, Hosea 1, but as for you, return to your God. Hold fast to love and justice. And wait continually for your God. Hold fast to love and justice in the midst of a chaotic world, in the midst of exile, in the midst of Babylon, in the midst of oppression, in the midst of marginalization, in the midst of being the other people, Israel. Hold fast to love and justice.
This is why I talk about love and justice a lot, actually, this verse, because I feel like we as a church need to hold fast to love and justice in the world that we live in. Love and justice. That we need to remember that our calling, our sacred calling, by being people of Jesus in this world, is to hold fast to love and justice. Love and justice. And then wait for God. See, the entire Christian faith is predicated on the work of restorative justice. Right? Look at Christ's work on the cross. One of the scenes that should always stick with us and confound us and we should meditate on is when Jesus is on the cross paying for a crime he did not commit, being heckled and ridiculed, he looks down and doesn't say, "You'll get your comeuppance." He says, "Father, what? Forgive them. They know not what they do." Our whole faith is predicated on restorative justice. Forgive them. Forgiveness at its heart is a work of restoration. Forgive them. Restore that which is broken in them. Obviously, they don't know who I am. They don't know what they do. They don't know what's happening here. Forgive them. See, the whole idea of resurrection, that Christ takes death and defeats it and brings about new life, is a work of restoration. You were once dead, now you're alive. Being a resurrection people is to believe that things that are dead can come back alive again. The things that are broken can be made whole again. Things that are oppressed and in slavery can be made free again. Things that are marginalized can be made great again. That even though you're down here, God can make you up here. Even though you're poor, in God's economy, you can be rich. It's a work of restoration because of the resurrection. And God invites us to believe, not just to say we believe, but to believe that resurrection is true and that resurrection changes everything. And that the work of death coming to life, of light going into darkness, actually happens still today. Hold fast to love and justice. See, justice is important because we are resurrection people. We are resurrection people in the midst of a world that sometimes looks dark, sometimes looks to value death. We are resurrection people. People of hope. People of new life. People of new creation. People of light. I often get, "Hey, Nate, are you going to tell these people that they're wrong?" Well, no, I'm going to point to new life. The new life is possible. How do you know? Because I've experienced it in my own life. Where I thought I was dead, I've become new again. Where I thought there was no hope, I have hope again. Where I thought that poverty and brokenness and hunger was going to get the final word, I experienced a new word, and that new word is life. Justice. See, there are some Christians who just flat out refuse to accept the truth of the resurrection. They say they do, and they'll be mad if you don't, but they refuse to actually live like restoration and new life is possible. See, these people, they preferred the old crippling identities. Well, these people are just, you know, drug addicts. These people are just alcoholics. These people are just, you know, they're on this side and we're on this side and we don't intermingle. And the old identities is all their identity will ever be. They preferred the old quarrels and the old silly resistances. Well, the church has never done that, so we can't do that. I to get a little personal, and I'm really bad at not getting personal, I'm a kid from a divorced family who experienced brokenness in my past, who loves people in addiction, who feels broken most days myself because of depression or because of anxiety, who gets hope in this world through Christ and the work of his church. And so, when people say, well, let's say these divorced people, well, they're just divorced. They're on the outside. I say, if they're on the outside, so is my mother, and I want to go with her. So is my father, and I want to go with him. Or these people over here are in addiction, and they say, well, they're just on the outside. And I say, well, so is my mother. So if she's in addiction, I'm going to go with her. And we'll follow the path of love and justice in whatever messy world she would be in today. Sometimes the church tries to be a little too clean on the outside, but on the inside, it just smells. I think Jesus called that whitewashed tombs to the Pharisees. On the outside, everything looks really good, but on the inside, you're dead. See, State Street has never tried to be that community. We've always acknowledged that all of us have brokenness. Some people look really good, by the way, and you're really good at masking it. And some of us don't have the same amount of brokenness, and some of us, we do seem to have it together better than others. And that's okay. But for those that don't, we don't treat them as others. Nor does Christ. We create environments of justice where restoration can happen for you, for me, for our neighbors, for our enemies, for our children, and we go forward from there. And this is the path of justice. This is why we don't judge the people that come to the PAC Center that are hungry. This is why at our community gardens, when things don't necessarily always go the way we had planned, we try not to get so frustrated. This is why at the preschool, we understand that education is so important that not all families can afford it. And we don't stand in condemnation or judgment over those who don't. Why? Because our whole faith is predicated on new life coming out of darkness, out of death. That the resurrection invites us to believe in new possibilities, new potential. See, I believe this. Maybe I'm reading the New Testament and the scriptures all wrong, but I believe this. Resurrection people remain hopeful and work for restoration in the failed places, people, and events of this world. Why? Because we find Jesus there. Now we bring Jesus there. We find Jesus is already at work there. That was the moment for me of complete spiritual transformation. I was 16 years old, traveling down Seavers Road, not far from John and Jane Slater's house. They live on Seavers. I won't tell you which house. I was driving down that road and bawling, still impacted deeply. I mean, it took a long time after that, but the death of my mother was still just looming deep inside of me. Lots of depression, lots of just anger, and I was yelling, just yelling at the top of my lungs, I don't want to live. If this is the broken world that I get to inherit now, this is not life for me. And I remember, it was, I didn't hear the audible voice of God. I'm not like, you know, I'm not one of them really spiritual people, really spiritual Christians, those pastors that have, apparently.
But I remember that there was this profound sense of invitation to new life. That your past life will never be forgotten. It'll never be that it didn't happen. There'll still be an impact and effects from it. But Nate, I'm inviting you into this new life of new creation where you can feel hope again. And it was just driving down that road. It was the first moment in probably over a year that I felt hope. And since then, I've been committed to saying what the world needs more of is not more reminders that there's darkness, but that light exists. That there's hope. See, resurrection people remain hopeful and work for restoration in the failed places, people, and events of this world, because in that van going down Seavers Road, God was already there. He didn't make it all better for me, but he reminded me that there's hope. That what was once dead in me can come alive again. What was once a world of brokenness can have restoration again. I believe this. I believe this story. I believe these truths of the resurrection. I believe them so much that it propels us to participate in acts of justice in this world, of hope, of restoration. See, I believe it so much. And our leadership believes it so much. And the people here believe it so much that it fuels the work of this church. Many, many moments of Julie Secor's ministry, she's felt the brokenness of kids in our neighborhood and the heaviness of the darkness that many people have to walk through every day of their life. And it's been moments where you have to remind yourself that in the end, the light wins. Jason and our volunteers at the PAC Center, days, moments. I remember Jason telling Becky when she started volunteering there that you're going to have moments where you're going to have to take a step back because the heaviness of it all can weigh on you. And it can rob you of your hope. It can rob you of the light. So don't forget to take those moments when you need to separate, to remind yourself that there's still hope. Resurrection people remain hopeful and work for restoration in the failed places, people, and events of this world. It's not just an idea. It is the path of faith for Christians. It is the natural outpouring of what we do as people committed to the cause of Christ. So here's my challenge. As we go forward, as we work out, our faith here at State Street, as we continue to embody this expression of love and justice here in downtown LaPorte, first is don't give up. Don't give up. Remind yourself the light wins. The light wins. At the end of Revelation, there's a new city and a new Jerusalem, and at the end, God is walking amongst his people. And the final word is not condemnation. Oops, the final word is not death. The final word is new life, new creation, new hope. Don't give up. It can seem dark. There are days that seem dark. Don't give up. You may have had a bad day. Your addiction may have got the best of you today. Don't give up. Your marriage may have failed. Now you're a single parent. Don't give up. You lost your job. You're not working the job you thought you would work, or you're not finding fulfillment in life, or you're struggling with depression or anxiety. Don't give up. You've been marginalized. You've been oppressed. You've been made an other, not only just by the society at large, but by other Christians. Don't give up. The light wins. Find your hope. So find your voice. I'm still learning to do that, finding my voice. I live in the tension of the scriptural command to honor everyone, and I want to honor everyone. And especially here, we do have a, you know, we have people that voted on different sides of the aisle. We have people committed to different parties. I have my own convictions on that. It's not that I don't have them, but I want to honor everyone. People in my family, we disagree on politics. We disagree on lots of different things here. We have matters of conscience here that, you know what, you disagree. That's fine. We're this is why values are so important. We're going the same direction still. But also, works of justice require us to find our voice. To find your voice. Find the thing and being able to articulate what restoration actually looks like in your own life, but in the life of people around you. When the Old Testament commands the people to speak on behalf and to seek justice for these people, God's asking them to find their voice. To speak light into darkness. And also to listen for your pulse. So, I go to the doctor quite a bit. I'm not sick regularly, but they do checkups and all these kind of things. And because I have an autoimmune disease. And so, of course, they have to, you know, listen to my heartbeat, listen to, you know, get the pulse, all these kind of things. I believe everyone here has different things about them, and God's given you a thing or an issue or something that you're passionate about that makes you come alive. I know some of you, and I know what some of them are. Some of you are really good at taking people on the outside and bringing them in, or taking people that feel like outsiders and making them insiders. Some of you, your passion is children, making sure that they don't feel discouraged, or making sure that they don't feel the impact of otherness or bullying or things like that. And you found your voice, and you listen for your pulse on how to make that happen in this world. But I think all of us have to have that time where we're listening and we're trying to figure out what our pulse is in this world. How do we, what place do we play in this world? And then finding our voice to articulate that. I'm learning how to do that now, even. I'm learning when to, you know, bite my tongue and shut my mouth. I say a lot of things that are unhelpful. And I've been called on it by people in this community. And I remember years ago, a dear friend of mine, you guys know Alan Johnston, messaged me after a message and said, hey, what you said there was really hurtful for this group of people. Didn't think about it. Again, it just comes out sometimes. And I thought, thank God for Alan Johnston for having a voice and being willing to speak up for the people that I hurt, that my words didn't bring life to, when I brought darkness instead of light, that he actually found his voice, spoke truth to what is power in this church. I'm the pastor. Thank God for that. Find your voice and listen for your pulse. Finally, be courageous. We're out of time, but be courageous. I saw this image. I don't know if you're a Humans of New York fan. It's one of my like favorite things. I love Humans of New York. But this guy on here looks super comfortable, by the way. Says, I'm trying to live my life without conflict so I don't say much. And honestly, that's probably not real far away from where I've been in my life. Trying to live my life without conflict and in doing so not saying much. So I see injustices, or I see people that are suffering from injustices, but I don't want to hurt people that I love that might be causing that. Or I don't want to hurt or separate people that might be a part of that thing that's causing this. And so I just try to keep quiet. Here's my tension. Part of me resonates with that. I don't want to live in conflict with anybody. For as much as possible, live at peace with everyone, as Scripture says. But I also don't want to miss the moment of speaking on behalf of those who are suffering from injustices either. It's this tension. How do you honor everyone? How do you live at peace as far as is possible with you, with everyone? But how do you also be an advocate for people who are suffering from injustices? Martin Luther King Jr. Tomorrow's Martin Luther King Jr. Day. I thought it's really interesting that in his letter from Birmingham jail, his probably most famous letter that he wrote, he talks about his disappointment. And when I read the letter, I locate myself precisely in his disappointment. Because he's not disappointed so much as with the outright racists of the South at the time. Sure, he's disappointed, but that's not the majority of where his disappointment kind of comes from. Black people in the South are going through these injustices in the 50s and the 60s, his disappointment actually was more with moderate white Christians who knew better, who actually agreed that there shouldn't be these injustices, but they kept their mouth shut because they didn't want to live in conflict with anybody. He says, all too many others have been more cautious than courageous. When I read that, I think, oh, am I valuing caution more than courage in my faith? And have remained silent behind the anesthetizing security of stained glass windows. Be courageous. Be brave. Be bold. And being a person of love and justice. I get so proud of my kids when they participate. And in their context, right, they go to elementary school, but my son Finley just doesn't seem to look a lot of times at what's the difference between people. So he'll say, yeah, that kid doesn't have anybody to play with him. So I just played with him. Why? Well, nobody should play alone. It's a work of justice right there. Or that kid over there sitting by himself at lunch, I'm going to go sit with him. Why? Nobody should have to be alone. That's a work of justice. Now, it's not that they don't love the people that are ostracizing, but they're valuing courage over caution. May we be so bold in our faith that if we were back in the 50s and 60s, we would have the courage to stand with our brothers and sisters who are being ostracized in Selma, for those who are being pushed aside wherever they are in this world, that we would have the boldness and courage in our faith as resurrection people who believe firmly in the promises of Jesus Christ, that all who call on the name of the Lord will be saved and made well, regardless of where you're from, what cultural background, what geographic background, all who call on the name of the Lord will be made well and saved. So we love Jesus here. So we value justice. We love Jesus here. So we work for restoration. We love Jesus, so we're invited to participate in his redemptive work today. This is why it's a value for us. Because God's natural outpouring of faith in the life of his people is justice. We're going to work into the Eucharist now, where God invites us to participate in a meal that is all about him breaking his body and shedding his blood for you. It's a remarkable act of forgiveness and restoration and invitation. And so we come to this moment of our service where we think about our own brokenness, where we think about the path of love and justice that we haven't necessarily embodied well. Maybe because somebody is a different race or a different cultural background, or they're on the wrong side of Lincoln Way or the wrong side of the tracks, or they're Presbyterians. We've decided we're going to make an other out of them. We ask for forgiveness. Maybe you've condemned and judged somebody
an addiction. We ask for forgiveness. Maybe you've condemned and judged the person that's brought darkness into this world and not given them a chance to experience the light. Darkness can't drive out darkness, as Martin Luther King Jr. says. Only light can do that. And we pray that's true in our life and in the world we inhabit. So right now we pray together as a community that God will forgive us, and that his kingdom will be made known today as we enter into this Eucharist. So will you pray with me? Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. The tables of Christ are open. Thank you. Amen. Will you please stand with us before we dismiss? A couple quick things. The beginning of February, we are changing service times. We announced this last week. But we are going, instead of a 9 o'clock service, to an 8:30 service. Instead of 10:45, a 10 o'clock. There is a discrepancy in our attendance here. More people here at our 9 o'clock than our 10:45. And instead of going to three services to get more room for here and things like this, we want to just try to work to balance some of this out. So I've had people say, is there a better service time to go to? If you have no preference, we're going to get out of here a little earlier at the 10 o'clock, and you can go to the 10 o'clock when we switch service times. I do encourage you to do that. If you can't, come to the 8:30, and we'll have coffee ready and going. But that does start February 4th. Also, February 11th is a new class opportunity here at State Street, The Conversation. It's actually 11th, according to Mark Pulis.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah, he came a little panicked when he said, wait a second, why does it say February 4th? And I said, Crane? No, I think we got that wrong. But it's actually February 11th. Don't look at the graphic. We actually have graphic that say both dates.
No, we have one that says the 14th.
Oh, we have one that's okay, it's not the 14th or the 4th. Third time's a charm, people. We will get it next time. But it's the 11th. You can sign up through your app or in the foyer. You can sign up there as well. Mark Bulis is one of our leadership team members. If you'd like to talk about the class and what the format will be, he is happy to talk with you about that. But we do want to invite you to participate in that. It's on Sunday morning. It's going to be a great class. A great time to also get to know some other people here. We will not be passing a plate for offering, though we do believe in honoring God with our finances. If you would like to give here, you can give in the two giving boxes. You've got your giving envelopes in your chairs, or go online to statestreet.tv, or download our app and do that as well. Also put your Connect cards in there if you'd like to be baptized or to serve, talk about your faith. Put that in your Connect cards, and we will talk to you this week. Hey, I'm glad that you're here. I'm glad that you made a special time of your Sunday and your week to gather with God's people here. And may we continue to strive to be people of love and justice in the places and the people that the places we are and the people that we meet. So go out today in the love of the Father, in the peace of His Son, Jesus Christ, and in the movement of the Holy Spirit. You are dismissed. Peace be with you. Yeah, we are a hot mess.
I know we often impress people with our great communication skills. I don't know. I mean, because I passed along whatever I was given, so.
It's okay. We'll just fix it. Yeah. We'll have a list. Let's fix it.
Yeah.
But yes, we do need to change that.
But I wish I'd known. I wouldn't have corrected it.
I know. You really like dumb, though. You really. I mean,
she's already out the back door.
It's like, finally, I got to say, no, you're wrong!
Thanks, Nate.
In humility.
You guys were late.
I told them.